Filipino researchers in the West Philippine Sea injured by a low-flying Chinese Navy helicopter. The international community has rallied behind the Philippines to condemn China's latest harassment. Zen Hernandez reports.
In a video released by the Bureau of Fisheries and Aquatic Resources, a Chinese Navy helicopter with tail number 57 can be seen hovering over Sandy Case 3 and 4 near Pag-asa Island on Saturday, where a team of scientists and researchers from the University of the Philippines Institute of Biology, National Fisheries Research and Development Institute, and the BFAR were conducting a marine resource assessment. BFAR personnel reported the helicopter hovered as low as 50 feet from the water for about 10 minutes, causing flying debris and injuries to the research crew. Gusts of wind created by the chopper also made it hard for an underwater drone operator to come out of the water and had to be rescued, while divers heard pinging sounds underwater, forcing the mission commander to recall the research team. This incident happened the same day the Chinese Coast Guard used water cannons on a Philippine resupply vessel in a Yungin Shoal. China's foreign ministry is standing by the actions of its Coast Guard as it accuses Manila of causing the provocations. The Department of Foreign Affairs has lodged a strong protest across various diplomatic channels to stress that China's continued interference in the Philippines' own exclusive economic zone is unacceptable and demanded that Chinese vessels leave immediately. The DFA further underscored that a Yungin Shoal and other maritime features within the Philippine EEZ is in accordance with international law, which was affirmed by the 2016 arbitral award. Beijing, however, lodged counter protests and insisted that the arbitral award is null and void due to the lack of consent from China. The Chinese Foreign Ministry also warned that China will continue to safeguard its maritime rights and interests. But Philippine Foreign Affairs Secretary Enrique Manalo says Manila is not backing down, adding several nations have expressed support for the country.
Just most recently in this incident at the Yungin Shoal, where China harassed and also prevented our ships from, tried to prevent our ships from resupplying our troops in Yungin Shoal, we had messages of support from over 20 countries, governments, who clearly stated the importance of adhering to international laws.
India is the latest country to back the Philippines, following statements from 21 other nations, including the United States, the United Kingdom, Japan, South Korea, Canada, Australia, the European Union, and several EU countries.
We are also convinced that the progress and prosperity of this region is best served by staunch adherence to a rules-based order. UNCLOS 1982 is particularly important in that regard as the constitution of the seas. All parties must adhere to it in its entirety, both in letter and in spirit. I take this opportunity to firmly reiterate India's support to the Philippines for upholding its national sovereignty.
Minister Jay Canchar is in Manila until March 27 as part of a three-country Southeast Asian trip, which also includes Singapore and Malaysia. This is his second visit to the Philippines, and he will also meet with Defense Secretary Gilbert Teodoro and will speak with President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
Our countries have a shared interest in a free, open, and inclusive Indo-Pacific region. The minister and I have decided to accelerate our maritime cooperation with a planned maritime dialogue with India to be held in Manila following the successful Track 2 dialogue in September last year.
Meantime, the Philippines is expecting the delivery of Indian-made BrahMos missiles intended for the coastal defense missions. Trade and cooperation is also an important domain that both countries are keen on expanding. Last year, Philippine exports to India exceeded $1 billion for the first time, according to Secretary Manalo, who also committed to prioritizing Indian visitors and investors in its e-visa program. Zen Hernandez, ABS-CBN News.
Multiple killings in Davao City barely a week after the son of former President Rodrigo Duterte took a page out of his father's playbook and declared a war against illegal drugs. More in this report.
Seven alleged drug personalities killed in the Philippine city of Davao in a span of several days as the city's police force cracked down on illegal drugs. Last Friday, Davao City Mayor Sebastian Duterte issued an ultimatum to those who deal in illegal drugs that they will be killed if they don't leave the city.
I hereby declare a campaign that this city is at war against drugs.
The Davao City Police asserts the drug personalities who were killed resisted arrest. It added that pieces of evidence such as illegal drugs and guns were also recovered from the crime scene. Authorities also clarify not all suspects were killed during the operations, as some of them also surrendered.
Iklaro ko lang na prior to the statement of the city mayor, meron na tayong kampanya sa illegal contra drug. The statement of the city mayor, both our moral, both the moral of the DCP of PNP, para magtrabaho ng doble sir, no? Para ma-stop ang illegal drugs dito sa Davao City.
The Human Rights Watch expresses concern over the killings in Davao City. It calls on the Marcos Jr. administration to not let the culture of impunity continue.
In fact, now I think now the challenge now is for President Marcos to really show that he, if he is serious about, you know, the so-called new phase of the drug war, that the drug war will not be as violent as before, he needs to step in. He needs to, I think, use the might of the national government to try to rein in PNP. All the national authorities should act on this, you know, coming up straight from the office of the president, the Interior Department. Davao City is not some, you know, independent federal state that they can just do whatever they want. You know, it is part of the republic.
The Commission on Human Rights, for its part, says while it recognizes the gravity of the drug problem in the country, putting the law in someone's hands will not resolve the problem, as it only perpetuates the culture of impunity, violence, fear, and threat. It adds, using extrajudicial means undermines the rule of law and destroys faith in legal systems. The Davao City Mayor's father, former President Rodrigo Duterte, also implemented his own bloody anti-drug campaign during his term. Thousands were killed in what authorities claim were legitimate police encounters. The killings have triggered an investigation by the International Criminal Court. It was suspended in November 2021, but in January 2023, the ICC authorized reopening the inquiry. In July 2023, the ICC Appeals Chamber also denied the Philippine government's appeal against the resumption of the inquiry. But President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has said he does not recognize the ICC's jurisdiction and that his government will not cooperate in the ICC's investigation of the previous administration's drug war.
Outgoing Philippine National Police Chief Benjamin Acorda Jr. set to leave his post nearly a year after assuming the position. But days before his retirement, there's still no word on who will be his successor. Raya Capulong reports.
Outgoing PNP Chief General Benjamin Acorda Jr. is preparing for his retirement on March 31. Acorda was supposed to retire on December 3, but President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. extended his term by 3 months. According to Acorda, Malacanang has yet to request a recommendation for his possible replacement.
So far, di pa kami nag-uusap. Wala pa, hindi pa ako hiningan ng recommendation. Isa na yun, naging packet tayo. We are ready to move out anytime kasi nakakaya naman na may bagong chief PNP na. Andyan pa yung mga gamit natin. And also, when it comes to all the things, mga documents and mga parades, preparations, caterings, invitations, programs, mga ganun. And end of tour of duty.
So the question remains, upon Acorda's retirement, who will be the next leader of the country's 232,000 strong police force? Among those who may have the inside track are members of the command group. In terms of seniority, the name of the number 2 in command, Deputy Chief for Administration Police Lieutenant General Emmanuel Peralta, stands out. Peralta has served as the Chief of the Directorial Staff. He had stints as the Chief of the Directorate for Operations and the Director of the Southern Police District. Peralta was also previously the director of the Police Regional Office 1 in the Ilocos region and a classmate of General Acorda from the PMA Sambisig class of 1991. He is set to retire in August 2024. In addition to the command group, some senior officials are seen as possible contenders. Among them is Comptrollership Director Police Major General Romel Francisco Marbil. Marbil served as the director of the Eastern Visayas Police and also headed the Highway Patrol Group. He is also part of the PMA Sambisig class of 1991. Marbil is set to retire in February 2025. Another potential candidate is Directorate for Operations Head Police Major General Ronald Lee. He was previously the director of the PNP Directorate for Human Resource Doctrine and Development, Deputy Director of the PNP Directorate for Intelligence, and Deputy Director for Administration of the PNP Intelligence Group. Like other senior officials, he also has a wealth of experience having served as Director of the PNP Criminal Investigation and Detection Group and Director of the PNP Drug Enforcement Group. Lee is a member of the PMA Tanglaw Diwa class of 1992 and is set to retire in May 2025. Another name that could be in the mix is National Capital Region Police Office Director Police Major General Jose Melencio Nartates Jr. Nartates served as the director of the Police Regional Office 4A or Calabarzon. He also held top posts such as director of the Directorate for Intelligence and the Directorate for Comptrollership of the PNP. Nartates is from the PMA Tanglaw Diwa class of 1992 and is set to retire in March 2027. According to Acorda, one of the challenges for the next PNP chief is reducing the number of crimes in the country. He also believes the issue of destabilization should not be ignored.
With regards to challenges, yun pa rin ang nanguna, how to make sure that yung mga threats na tatanggap natin when it comes to the criminality and of course the challenge, of course, na to make sure na hindi lalala yung situation. So how to keep the numbers going down in terms of criminality and how to make our crime solution effective, pati mga conviction rate namin. With regards to destab, hindi naman natin gano'n nakapan yan, na-establish yan. May mga rumors, may mga sabi-sabi, but hindi natin establish yan. But nevertheless, yung susunod should be on the lookout always.
Acorda also expressed his gratitude towards all police personnel for their dedicated service and sacrifices, as well as the trust placed in them by the public.
I'm thankful to the whole police force, magmula taas hanggang baba, lalo-lalo na those na nasa kalsada. And sa mga kamag-anak ng mga nagbis ng buhay, I am very sorry. In as much as possible, ayoko may magbubis ng buhay, but it's all part of the service. Ako'y nagpapasalamat sa kanilang servisyo.
Rayo Capulong, ABS-CBN News.
Let's get an update on the situation at the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange for the Holy Week Exodus. ABS-CBN's Karen De Guzman joins us on the line for that. Karen, over to you.
Katrina, the Parañaque Integrated Terminal Exchange anticipates to serve 150,000 to 160,000 passengers on Holy Wednesday, as today is the last working day. Some regular bus trips to Bicol are already fully booked for Holy Week. But according to PITX Corporate Affairs Officer Colleen Calbasa, the ticketing booths at the terminal are still open for walk-in passengers and additional units will be deployed. Helen Candelaria Lodes from Cavite has been at the terminal since last night in hopes of getting a bus ticket to Bicol. She experienced difficulties at the terminal because the escalators and air conditioners were not operational at midnight.
Masakaling maisingit ba kasi isa lang naman ako, pero alauna pa mamaya pa ng mapo ng aming biyahe. Mas ang hirap pang umakyat, gawa nang sarado na yung mga escalator nila. Mainit nga, patay aircon eh.
Rosaline Rentoy, together with her children and grandchild, also went early to the terminal to buy tickets straight from the counter since their trip is also fully booked.
Dapat 24 pa kami dapat. Eh, fully booked na pati. Tsaka sabi nung sa cashier, 27, pipili ako ng madaling araw. At masabi ko lang, dapat talaga agahan nila magpa-reserve.
As of 8 in the morning, more than 22,000 passengers were already recorded by the management. EITX advises passengers to book their tickets at the terminal if they still don't have them. They also offer cargo services for the transportation of goods and packages in provinces. Sharp objects and flammable items are not also allowed at the terminal. And due to pertussis, passengers are encouraged to put their mask on if they experience cough. Katrina?
Thanks for that update, Karen De Guzman, and keep safe.